Welcome to the Mac Academy tutorial system presented by Florida Marketing International Incorporated.
Hello again. Welcome to tape number 2 of our Mac Academy training video series on Microsoft Word 4.0. My name is Lou Featherolf, and I'm going to be your host again on this tape. We're going to take a look at some of the more advanced aspects of Microsoft Word. We'll take a look at headers and footers, adding columns of numbers, using the glossary, doing style sheets, footnoting, indexing, and many, many more subjects. I'd like to begin with the discussion about adding columns of numbers in Microsoft Word. So if you're seated at your computer, just look at the screen, that is your video screen, and watch what I'm doing on the computer. Then once I've accomplished what I'm doing, simply take a look back at your screen and try to replicate. I've got a document here that simply talks about a series of products that have been sold from our software company, Positive Works Incorporated. It may be that you create documents like this and you want to add columns of numbers, but instead of going to your desk and getting out your calculator to add those numbers, you want to be able to add them on screen. Word will allow you to add columns of numbers, but you must select the column first. If we place our insertion point next to the 6, for example, next to this number 600, and we want to select the column, we could drag through that number 600, but if we drag down to include the numbers below, of course, that selects everything between, doesn't it? Well, that won't accomplish what we want to accomplish. You can do what is called an inside select. That is, we can select just this column of numbers inside this paragraph by holding the Option key down. So if you hold your Option key down and drag through those numbers, you'll see we can select just those numbers themselves without selecting any other information. Once those are selected, if you release the Option key and release your mouse button, then you can go to your Utilities menu. Notice this is a new menu now, a new menu item from previous versions of Word. Notice the third to last option here says Calculate. The keyboard command is Command equals. If you release on Calculate, Word sums the numbers in that column and places the results down here in your status box in the lower left-hand portion of the screen. Now, the number will stay in that status box as long as you don't do anything else. But as soon as you click on the document or place your insertion point to put the total in, it will leave the status box, but that's okay because it still lives in the clipboard. So if I place my insertion point up here and then tab over to where I want the number to be entered, notice now my page number shows in the status box. But we can still get the total of our calculation by going to the edit menu and come down to paste. When we release on paste, notice it pastes in the number. Then you can place your insertion point between the 2 and the 6 perhaps and put a comma in, or format the number however you see fit. One more time, you simply place your insertion point and drag through the numbers by holding the Option key down when you drag. But let's take this one step further. Let's place some minus signs in front of these numbers. And in addition to that, around the number 415, let's put a couple of parentheses. So I'll put a left parenthesis in front and a right parenthesis behind. Word will sum these numbers, and it will recognize also that these are negatives. So when it calculates the total of this column, of course, it'll be subtracting those values out. So again, if we place our insertion point, hold the Option key down on your keyboard, drag through those numbers, including the negative signs and the parentheses. Now, once they're all selected, simply go up to the Utilities menu and come down to Calculate. When you release on Calculate, you'll notice in the status box in the lower left-hand corner, it tells us the sum of these numbers, including the negatives, is 361. Place your insertion point where you want it to go. In this case, I'll need to tab over one to get to the column under June of 1989. Once the insertion point is placed where we want the number to be pasted in, simply go to the Edit menu and come down to paste, and it pastes the result in. Now let's use this example to demonstrate another concept in Word. Have you ever created a document like this where you want to put a dotted line from one category to another so that the eye naturally follows across? That dotted line or that extension from one caption to another is called a leader, a tab leader. You can put tab leaders in Word very easily. Most often, beginning users will do something like this. They simply place the insertion point and start hitting the period. And you go all the way across till you get over close to your column where you're running to. And then the whole document shifts on you and the formatting goes out the window. Well, that's not the best way to do it. We'll take all those dots out. Let's tell Word to do this for us automatically by placing our insertion point where we want the tab leader to run to. Then we'll go up to our format menu and come down to Format Paragraph. When we release on paragraph, you'll notice these are some of the formatting attributes that you can assign to paragraphs. Notice in the lower left-hand corner down here, there's a little button that says Tabs. If we click once on Tabs, a second dialog box appears. And in this dialog box, it tells us that there are five different kinds of tabs available to us on the ruler and four different kinds of leaders. None has been selected at this point in time. So in order to select one of these others, the first thing we should do is simply look up the column, look up from the beginning of the column, or the end of the column, I should say, up into the ruler to see the tab that governs that column. And notice in this case, it happens to be a decimal tab. Now, it's not significant that I'm using a decimal tab here. Any tab would do. But since it is a decimal tab, if I just click once on the tab with my mouse pointer, you'll notice it activates that tab, and it tells me that the position of that tab is 3.181 inches from the left margin. Now that I have activated the tab, I can simply select one of these radio buttons for the leader that I want. Let's choose the series of dots by clicking on this radio button, then click on OK, click on OK again, and you'll see that Word puts them all in for you all at once. Let's try it one more time on this column. We'll place our insertion point where we want it to go. We'll go to the Format menu, come down to Paragraph. When we release on Paragraph, we see the paragraph options available. If we click on Tabs, that gives us the tab box, so the tab dialog box. And now let's follow this column up to the ruler, and notice our tab now sits at the 5-inch mark. So if I click once on that tab to select it, it tells us that it is positioned at 5 inches on the ruler and that it is a decimal tab. In this case, let's choose the dashes that are mid-character high as our leader. We'll click on OK, then click on OK again, and you'll see it puts those dashes in. Notice, however, right here that a negative sign precedes each of these numbers, and the dash leader looks just like a negative sign, so this would probably not be the best choice of a leader if you're going to use negative signs. Rather, you would use this leader if you are encasing your negative number in parentheses. Now, you'll notice when we gave Word the command to do the tab leader for this paragraph, it filled them all the way down. Suppose in your mind's eye for just a moment that none of this text that I have selected is there. We're just about ready to type the text in this document, so our insertion point would normally be placed over here. And if it were, we would type in the text, real estate analysis. It would end up here, and then typically the next thing you do would be to type a tab. Your insertion point would jump over to here. You'd type in the number 600. Your insertion point would end up there. Then you'd hit the tab key again to jump over to here. You would type -478, and your tab key would end, or your insertion point would end up there. Most often, people are prompted then to hit the return key to drop down one line. If you hit the return key, what does that do for you? It creates a new paragraph. Your insertion point ends up right here, but in the process, you've created a new paragraph, and that's really not what's desirable when you're creating columns of numbers. You would like to have this whole document, this whole center portion of the document, be one paragraph long. And in fact, that's the way that I created it. You can see that by going to the Edit menu and coming down to Show Paragraph Symbols. You'll recall that when you hit the hard return key, that is when you hit the return key by itself, you get these little paragraph symbols as is shown at the bottom of this column. But notice at the end of each of these lines now there are arrows lying on their side. These are called end of line markers. And those are the little markers you get when you hold the Shift key down and hit the return key. A shifted return, that is sometimes called a soft return, will simply allow you to drop down one line, but in the process allows you to stay within the same paragraph. And that's significant in this case because now this whole section is one paragraph. And since it is one paragraph, when we issued the tab leader command to put our tab leader in here, since we went to format paragraph to obtain our tabs, and since the ruler is paragraph specific in Word, you see it filled the tab leader all the way down through this entire paragraph on the left-hand side of this column. And when we issued that same command over here, it filled the tab leader we chose all the way down on the left-hand side of this column. If at this point, instead of using a shift return, we had simply hit a hard return, that is the return key, without holding the shift key down, and if we did the same here and all the way down this document, we would have created 9 different paragraphs in the process. And since there would have been 9 different paragraphs, when we issued the tab leader command over here, we would have gotten just one line because the tab leader applies to a specific paragraph. Likewise, over here, we would have gotten just one tab leader line. We would have had to have issued this tab leader command 18 times to have accomplished what we did here in just 2 commands. So it's significant. When you're creating columns of numbers, it is significant simply to remember that you should use your shifted return to simply drop down a line and stay within the same paragraph. Consequently, when you issue your tab leader command, you will get tab leaders that fill all the way down in that paragraph. All right, now let's turn our paragraph symbols option off by going to Edit, Hide Paragraph Symbols. And let's close this document without saving the changes. And we'll take a look at another document that I have prepared that has some other numbers in it to show you how you can do some further calculations in Word. Now, I've shown you how to calculate columns of numbers like these. You can also calculate numbers written on a single line. Here we have 25 with an asterisk sign, which indicates multiplied by. 25 multiplied by 2 equals 50. Well, we know that. We can get Word to calculate it for us by selecting those numbers and simply going to Utilities, Calculate. And Word calculates the result. So you can do it horizontally as well as vertically. Word will calculate the 4 basic mathematic functions, that is, it will do addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Notice down here where we have 100 plus 3 times 5, typically the way you would more correctly write this, at least in terms of algebra, you would put the 3 times 5 in parentheses and multiply that product, or add that product rather, to 100. But notice how Word operates. If we do a selection here and calculate the result of 100 times 3 plus 5, or plus 3 times 5, we get a result of 515. So that is in fact 100 plus 3, which is 103, times 5, which is 515. Notice what happens when we select these numbers where we use parentheses around the 5 times 3. Algebraically, the correct result would be 15 plus 100, which would be 115. But when you calculate, you still get 515. In other words, in this case, Word does not recognize a series of numbers encased in parentheses as that operation to be carried out first. It simply ignores the parentheses in this case and does the same thing as it did in the example before. All right, well, let's close out this document. And let's take a look now at headers and footers. You may wish to create a document that at the top of your printed page, your first printed page, you would have text that's not a part of the normal text string of your document. That additional text that appears on the printed page is called a header. And likewise, text that would appear at the bottom of a printed page is called a footer. Now, you can create headers and footers fairly easily in Word. You'll notice under the document menu, the first 2 options are open header and open footer. So let's open up a document that I have already prepared to demonstrate headers and footers. I call it the header demo. It's a document that talks about computer security. If we would like to place a header or certain text at the top of our document that's not a part of the normal text string here, we can do so by going to the document menu and come down to Open Header. We're going to take it one step farther than that. We're going to create a header and a footer that are unique just to the first page. And then we'll create headers and footers that appear on pages 2 through the rest of the document that are the same. So in order to separate that first page out so that the header and footer are unique to that page, we have to change our menu item. That is, we need to add a couple of items to the document menu. To accomplish that, we first go to the Format menu and come down to Format Section. Under Format Section, you'll see in the lower center portion here a little box that says Header and Footer. This tells us that our header will be 1/2 inch down from the top edge of the piece of paper, and our footer will live 1/2 inch up from the bottom edge of the piece of paper. And if we place our hot dot of our arrow in this little box down here and click in it to select that box, this first page special option will allow us then to modify our menu so that now the document menu says Open Header and Footer and Open First Header and First Footer. So let's take a look at the first header. Notice now it opens an active window. It's an active window because it has a close box and horizontal lines in the title bar. So we can work outside of this window if we want without having to answer some default first. Well, let's show a ruler in our window. So let's go to the Format menu and come down to Show Ruler. And let's center align the text by clicking on our center alignment icon. And now let's type a heading in there that further describes what this document is. This is a part of a research paper. So we'll type research paper in here. And then let's select that text by dragging through it. And let's format the text by going to the Format menu and come down to Bold. Command-Shift-B is the keyboard equivalent. And let's increase its point size by going to the Font menu and come down to about 24 point. All right, that looks pretty good. We click anywhere off of that to deselect it. That looks good enough for our header that will appear at the top of the first printed page. So let's close that window. And now let's go back to the document menu and open up the window for our first footer. That is information that will appear at the bottom of the first printed page. Let's also show a ruler in this window. And let's put a dynamic date and dynamic time in this window. That is, dates and times that will change as time goes on. So you'll notice in the upper left-hand corner of our window here, we have three icons. This little calendar page icon is your date icon. If I click on it, it will paste today's date into our header or into our footer. If I click on the time icon, it will also paste the current time into our document. Now they've been placed right next to one another, so let's place our insertion point between them and then tab the time over to the right-hand side of our document. So the time is over on the right, date on the left. Now these are dynamic, that is, they change as time goes on. The way you know that is simply to show your paragraph symbols, and you'll notice that there is a dotted box that appears around those numbers. That tells us they are being fed from the system folder. And a little later on, the time will read later than 9:53. And if we were to open the document tomorrow, it would read 7:19:89. Well, let's turn the paragraph symbols off, and let's close that window. Now let's open up the header that we want to appear at the top of our second printed page and on pages thereafter in the document. Now, these windows look all the same. The only difference is the title. In our title bar here, this now is the header for pages 2 through the rest of the document. Let's show a ruler in this window as well. And let's right align or make our text flush right so that it will then type to the left from the right margin. And let's put a continuation notice in this window. That is a notice that tells the reader that the document continues on succeeding pages. So we'll type something like this in. Computer security continued. Now this will appear at the top of pages 2 through the rest of the document. So we'll close that window. And let's get our last option, which is open footer, the footer that will appear on pages 2 through the remainder of the document. And let's show a ruler in this window as well. Now let's do some page numbering in this footer. We'll center align the text. And if you simply go over here and click on this little page numbering icon, it's the same one that you will recall appears in your print preview window. Click on that page numbering icon and it pastes the number in for us in our document. Now, one of the nice things about numbering pages while you're using a footer is that you can format these numbers. So if you simply select the number, we can assign some formatting attributes to it. Let's make it bold. And just for effect, let's increase its font size to about 18 point so we can see it really stand out. All right, now this is what will appear on pages 2 through the remainder of the document. Now that we have effected those changes to our headers and footers, let's go to the print preview under the file menu and see what the changes have been to our document. Notice now at the top of our document, it shows research paper, 1/2 inch down from the top edge. It simply adjusts the size of our top and bottom margins to accommodate this header. The header will live between the margin and the edge of the piece of paper. And down here at the bottom, we see a date and time. Now, if you'd like to see this blown up, you'll recall that previous versions of Word had a little icon up here with a magnifying glass on it we could get, then come down here and double-click to blow that version up. Well, now, in Word version 4, if we simply go to this area and double-click, Word changes to the page view. This is an editing mode now that we're in. And you'll notice now as I scroll down the document, we see the document with the date and time at the bottom. Notice now the time has changed from 9:53 to 9:57. So it is, in fact, dynamic. It is changing as time goes on. Now, while we're in this page view mode, if we wish to look at the second page, we can go down to the little arrows at the bottom of the page and click on the down arrow to go to the second page. And now let's scroll backwards to see our continuation notice. Whoops, it shifted right back to the first page again. Let's go back up and try that again. We'll click down just to see our continuation notice at the top of the second page. Then if we scroll down to the bottom of the document, you'll see at the bottom we have our page number. And notice that Word defaulted to the number 2. It recognized that we had a special first page footer. And so instead of putting the number 1 as we saw it in the footer, it changed it to number 2, recognizing something special occupies that footer on the first page. Now to get out of the page view, of course, you've got to go back to your utilities menu, or rather your document menu, and come down to page view. Releasing on page view brings us back to the galley view, and we can scroll back to the beginning of the document. So you'll see, headers and footers are fairly easy to do in Microsoft Word 4.0. Let's take a moment now and talk about the glossary. The glossary in Microsoft Word, you might think of the glossary in Word the same way that you think of the scrapbook in the Macintosh. That is, the glossary is a storage place for those things that you would put into your documents or those things that you would use on a repetitive basis. Now, what would be candidates for your glossary? Perhaps you're in education and you create examinations for your different classes throughout the day and you'd like to mix and match the questions on your exams so that each class gets a different exam. You could simply store your questions in a glossary in Word and then simply paste them into differing documents. Another example might be, those who are in the medical profession who have a need to type documents where medical terms are often inserted in those documents. And medical terms have long, unusual spelling sometimes. And in order to overcome spelling errors, if you simply create a glossary filled with those medical terms, you can paste them out of the glossary into your documents and overcome spelling difficulties. Well, on the screen now, I've got a letter that I'll use to demonstrate the glossary. You may be in the business of writing letters to your customers, perhaps, wherein there is certain language that you always put in your letters, a letterhead perhaps that you want to put on your document, things that would appear in numerous letters. you may want those as candidates for your glossary. So we can simply select those and put them in the glossary and then call them back at will. Now notice this letterhead right here. This is a little letterhead we've developed for our software company, Positive Works. Suppose we want that letterhead to live in the glossary, to be able to call it up and paste it into documents at will. If you simply select that letterhead, go to the Edit menu, come down to Glossary. Command-K is the keyboard equivalent. Now you'll notice we're prompted with an active window. The active window indicates to us that in the glossary there are a number of items that live there automatically. Those that have the little dot in front of them, in other words, the dates can be pasted from your glossary into your documents. The dates in long or abbreviated form, they'll come in numeric form or in alpha or letter form. There is also an index option and some page numbering options along with times that you can put in, times printed out with minutes and seconds and so forth. Well, we want to add some text to this glossary. So now that we have that text selected, let's go down into this name box and give this glossary item a name, and let's call it letterhead. Now that we've given it a name, we simply click on the little define button over here. When you click on define, Word will take the name you have given that glossary item and it will put it up here in this directory in alphabetical order, and it will show us the first line of text for that glossary item and an ellipsis after it indicating that there is more text to follow. All right, let's click anywhere off of that window to bring our document to the front as the active window. Typically, you wouldn't put the name and address of individuals to whom you're writing letters. That is, if these are to different individuals at different times. So let's scroll up and take a look at what else is in this document. Well, now here's a paragraph that says, "Thank you very much for your recent inquiry into our line of products. It's really great stuff." This is canned language, isn't it? It's the kind of language that you would use as a friendly introduction to a letter. So why not put this canned language into the glossary? We can call it up at will later on. So let's double-click in our selection bar to select that paragraph. Now that it's selected, we'll go to the Edit menu, come down to Glossary, and let's give this glossary item a name. And let's call it our thank you paragraph. I'll hit the Option 7, which gives a little paragraph symbol. That simply allows me to put a shorter name in there rather than typing the whole word paragraph out. Now we'll click on the Define button. The name, thank you paragraph, goes into our glossary in alphabetical order, and the text with an ellipsis after it follows. And let's try it another time. Let's take these two paragraphs and select the both of them. Since it says we only sell our software at seminars, you've got to come to one. If you have any further questions, write me a letter. Well, that's canned language too, isn't it? So let's go to the Edit menu and come down to the glossary. And let's give these paragraphs a collective name. Let's call this Seminar Paragraphs. And this time I typed the whole word out. Click on Define. That puts its name in and shows us the last line of text. And then last, let's select our closing here. Since I always sign my letters the same way, we'll put that information into the glossary as well. We'll give it a name. Let's call this a closing. And we'll click on Define. Now our closing is an entry in the glossary. Let's click our Close box to put that away. We'll scroll back to the beginning of the document. Let's put this document away, and let's open a new one. File, New. And now let's put some of those glossary items that we just created into this new letter. We'd like to start this letter with a letterhead from our company, Positive Works. So let's go to the Edit menu and get the glossary item out. So we'll click on Glossary. And now let's scroll through this little directory here until we find our letterhead. There's the name letterhead. We click on it, then click on Insert. And notice it pastes that letterhead fully formatted the way it lives in the glossary. It pastes it into this document. And we're off and running. We drop down a few lines. We may want to put a date in here. Drop down a few more lines. Then we'll put an addressee in here, perhaps a name and an address and the city. and drop down a few more lines and put a greeting in here. And now let's drop down a couple of lines and let's put that first paragraph in. What did we call that paragraph? Our introductory paragraph we called a thank you paragraph. So if we go to the edit menu, come to the glossary, let's search for thank you paragraph. We'll scroll down to the T's. There it is. Click on it. Click on insert, or double clicking accomplishes the same thing. So if we double click, that inserts that paragraph fully formatted. Now we may want to drop down and tab in and put some personalized text in here so the person really does know we're writing them a personal letter, not just some canned letter. All right, and we'll drop down further and let's put our next paragraph in here. We called that our seminar paragraph. Now this is a rather cumbersome way to do it, don't you think? I mean, you have to take your hands off of the keyboard, you go to the mouse, you go up to the edit menu, come down to glossary, scroll through the glossary directory to find your item, click on it, click on insert, and then come back to the document. In the meanwhile, your hands have been off the keyboard the whole time. There is a shortcut to that whole process. The way you can get these items into your document using the keyboard is simply to hold your command key down. At the same time, you hit your backspace or your delete key. So command backspace, you'll notice now on the screen, it activates our little status box down here in the lower left-hand corner. And it gives us a prompt with the word name. It's prompting us to give the name of our glossary item. We call that one a seminar paragraph, so let's type that in. And the entry must come in exactly as it lives in the glossary. So we type seminar paragraphs, then we simply hit the enter key, and it enters that text into our document. Scroll up a little further, we want to put our closing in. We use the shortcut command backspace or command delete and simply type in the name of that glossary item, which is closing, and hit the enter key, and it puts our closing in. And now you see we have a fully formatted letter in a far shorter period of time than if we had gone through that document and formatted it as we went. So this is how you add items to your glossary. Well, that prompts the question then, perhaps, how is it that you delete items from a glossary? Well, if we open the glossary again and want to delete an item, notice there's no delete button in here. Well, that's all right. The way you delete items is simply to click on and select that item. And since this is an active window, we do not have to answer these defaults first. We can simply go outside of that window to our menu bar and come down to Cut. If we release on Cut, Word prompts us with this dialog box that says, are you sure you want to delete this glossary entry? If we really do, we can click on the Yes button, and it takes it out of the glossary. But remember, whenever you issue a Cut or a Copy command in Word or in most Microsoft and Macintosh applications, that information is cut to the clipboard. Now, there are some exceptions, but as a general rule, that's where it goes. So that information still lives in the clipboard. If we wanted to retrieve it, we could bring it back. Well, let's delete another item. Suppose we want to now delete the letterhead. We select it, go to the Edit menu, and say Cut. That cuts the item out as long as we answer this default saying Yes. And now the new item, letterhead, lives in the clipboard, and the previous item was bumped out. So now closing is no longer a part of our document. So that's how you delete items from your clipboard or from your glossary. Now suppose you create a glossary and you have a long list of terms in the glossary and you forget just what the names of these items are. And you'd like to see those names printed out. Well, you can print your glossary. Remember now, this is an active window. And so if you simply go up to the File menu, you can come down to Print. And when you release on Print, Word will print an alphabetical listing of your glossary, and along the left-hand margin it will print the glossary name in bold print, and then it'll give you indented under each name the glossary text. So you can print your glossaries out if you have long glossaries and refer to them off-screen. Now suppose we wanted to save this glossary. Suppose we had just added, perhaps 60 or 70 medical terms to our glossary, and we wanted to save this glossary under another name. Again, since this is an active window, we can go to the File menu and come down to Save As. And when you release on Save As, Notice Word prompts us now with this dialog box that says save the glossary as something. And so we would simply give what we had previously called the standard glossary. We would give this glossary a new name, perhaps something like this. And then we would click on Save. Then Word would save this glossary to our disk. Now we would have a second glossary in addition to our standard glossary. We would have one with medical terms in it. All right, well, let's cancel this because we really don't want to save these glossary items here. And let's exit this document without saving the changes. Now let's talk for just a moment about facing pages. Suppose you want to create a document that you know you're going to print at some point in time, and that printing is going to involve some sort of a binding. Suppose, for example, it's a manual that you're writing, and it has 5 or 6 chapters, and you know you're going to print the document and bind it perhaps in a loose leaf binder with 3 holes, or maybe permabinding. You would like to have the inside margins of your text widened to be able to accept your binding mechanism. Well, you can create facing pages options in documents fairly easily in Word. I'll go back to the File menu now and open up a document. Just any document will do. In this case, I'll open up one that says a header demo. This is a fairly lengthy document, and this will demonstrate facing pages fairly nicely. If we go to our Format menu and come down to Format Section, or rather Format Document, you'll notice along the top here, it tells us what our margin settings are for this document. It says the top and bottom margins are set now so that text will begin to appear 1 inch up, 1 inch from the top edge of the piece of paper, and 1 inch up from the bottom edge of the piece of paper. And it says here left and right. Our left and right margins are 1 1/4 inches each. Well, this first little box over here on the left that says mirror even odd margins, this is the option that allows you to create margins that are wider on the respective piece of paper that will receive the inside margin, I should say, on the respective piece of paper that will receive your binding. So if we click in that little box right there, notice now what used to say left and right margin now says inside and outside margin. Well, let's go up here and increase the margin size by selecting the number 1, and we'll put a 2 up there. So we're adding 1 inch to our inside margins. And that inside margin, of course, is the margin that appears on the inside edge of the document where your binding will attach. So if we click on OK at this point, you'll notice on the display screen, everything shifts over to the left. But to see the effect of what we have accomplished here, we need to go to Print Preview and take a look at the preview of the document. Now you'll notice, as a matter of good form, Word automatically places your text on the right-hand page, or the right-hand side of your dual-page document, and it has added 1 inch in here for our margin. So you see the distance from the left margin of text out to the left edge of the piece of paper is about 2 1/4 inches. Our 1 1/4 inch margin on the right has remained intact. Well, if I click in the scroll bar below our scroll box, and then it will scroll over. Now we'll see pages 2 and pages 3, and you'll notice the left margin here is small, the right margin larger. So the inside margin has been increased on each of these pages. But where do you suppose Word gets the space for this inside margin? Our document is fixed in width, that is, it is 8 1/2 inches wide, and originally we had 1 1/4 inches right margin and 1 1/4 inches left margin. Well, 1 1/4 plus 1 1/4 is 2 1/2. 2 1/2 from 8 1/2 leaves 6 inches of space. However, we had 1 inch taken out for our facing pages option here. That, therefore, only leaves us 5 inches of text space. So what Word does is it collapses or compresses our text, and in the compression process wraps it around to the next page and keeps wrapping it right on through our document till we get to the end. Well, notice now as we're looking at page 2, we see a stranded heading down here. This heading should appear up here at the top of the page with this paragraph with which it is associated. Well, we can do some basic editing in the print preview mode. That is, we can change our page break and force this document or this heading to appear at the top of the document by going to the margins icon and clicking once on the margins icon. Notice our margin settings now are shown here. Now, we don't want to change our margins in this case, do we? Because if we were to change our bottom margin on a document, on a page, it would change that margin for each similar page all the way through the document. Instead of changing margins, we're going to want to deal with our page break. Notice the little dotted line you see down here below this text. That widely spaced dotted line represents a repagination page break in Word. On this page over here, if I click over here, there is also a page break, but it just happens to be sitting right now on top of our margin line. So if we put the hot dot of our arrow right up on top of that page break, you'll notice the pointer turns into a set of crosshairs. While it is in that shape, if we simply grab that page break, we can drag it backwards above that text and release it. And as long as there is room at the end of the document, Word will then wrap that text below the page break up to the top of the next page. Now, instead of being a repagination page break here, this is now a manual or forced page break in Word. So a good rule of thumb is whenever you're going to do mirror even odd pages that gives you this facing pages option, it's a good idea to go through and look at every page of the document to make sure that you have no stranded orphans or widows on your document. Now, that heading stranded over on the one side over there is called an orphan. Word does not take care of orphans automatically, but it does control widows. A widow would simply be a piece of text that appears at the top of another page of your document. For example, if you were creating a document that you knew to be 5 pages long and you send it to the printer, and formatting changes a bit so that at the top of the 6th piece of paper you have one word that appears at the top of that page, that one word is known as a widow. One word or one line of text. Now, Word controls widows automatically. If you look at the Format menu and come down to Format Document, you'll see one little box in here that says Widow Control. Word automatically, by default, controls widows. That is to say, if Widow Control is selected, it will not allow just one word to go to the top of the next page or one line, but rather will take at least 2 lines with it in the process. All right, so facing pages option is very handy when you're creating documents that you want to bind with some sort of binding mechanism. Well, let's close this document now. And let's go to our file menu and open up another. This one will be our index document. You may want to create a document where at the back of your document you want to have an index, that is a listing of terms perhaps, and the page numbers associated with them that can be referenced in the main text of your document. You may be writing a book where at the back of the book you would like to have a list of those terms for the reader. Well, this particular document that I've prepared here shows how to create indexed items. Notice the document as it is formatted. Now I have some paragraph headings at the top of each paragraph, and I have them in bold print simply so that they stand out and it's a bit easier to see on your screen. Notice at the beginning of this string of text up here at the top, there is a period, an I, and a period, and a dotted line that appears underneath that marker. That little marker right there is called an indexed mark. That was placed in the document so that Word will recognize that the text following that period, I period, is going to be an indexed item. Notice the ending command over here is a semicolon, and that semicolon also has a dotted underline under it. Now, maybe a bit difficult to see on your screen because the width of that semicolon is so thin, but there is indeed a dotted line underneath that text. You need to put these beginning and ending codes around your items that you want to live in the index. The way these were created, I'll demonstrate for you now by going down to this third paragraph heading down here where it says erasing mistakes. I have not yet formatted these, and so I'll do it manually to show you how you can format these items so they will appear in your index. Simply type in the period, a lowercase I and a period, then go back and select that text. While it is selected, you go to your Format menu and come down to Format Character. Now under the format character box, you'll notice we've got a number of character formatting options here along the left. If I click on the last one that says hidden, then click on OK, Word will place the dotted underline underneath that period, the I and the period, and that shows us now that that text is hidden from the view of the printer. We see it on the face of our document here. You'll even see it in print preview, but the printer does not see it, so when it prints, those will not be visible. The ending code is simply a semicolon, so you place your semicolon in there, select it, do the same thing. Go to Format, Character, and click on the hidden attribute, then click on OK, and that places the dotted underline under that text. Now there's another method, a shortcut method. You can simply select text that you want to appear in your index and go to the document menu and come down here to this option that says Insert Index Entry. And by releasing on Insert Index Entry, Word will automatically put your beginning code, the period, the I, the period, and also puts it in hidden form. We could also end this with a semicolon, select it, and hide that text as well by going to Format Character and click on Hidden. Well, I've done that for the rest of this document all the way through. Let's go down just a bit further and see some of the other codes that were placed in here. Now here I have a forced or a manual page break. So on the second page, I've got a couple of other options here. Notice this particular indexed item will read delete words, but notice between the two, there is a colon in there with a dotted line underneath it. That colon that is hidden text was placed as a marker in there to let Word know that there's going to be some nesting take place. That is, the word words will appear under the word delete in our index, and the word letters will also appear under or nested below the word delete. All right, now let's scroll back to the beginning of our document. Now that we have placed all of the beginning and ending codes in the document, let's go to our Utilities menu and come down to Index. When we release on Index, Word prompts us with this little dialog box asking the question, is this going to be a nested or a run-in index? It is nested, and we'll ask it to show all of our characters, so we'll click on Start. Word will repaginate the document and shift the document up and place our index at the back of the document after a section break. So you'll see now each of these items that we had encased with our beginning and ending codes now show up here in our index, and the respective page number that they live on shows right next to them. Notice our nesting here. The word delete is here, and the words letters and words both nest under the word delete. And notice Word also put them in alphabetical order. They appeared in reverse order in our document, but Word automatically put them in alphabetical order. So we could print this document. Since this is a section break, and in this case, a section break will treat the text below it just like a page break. If you don't recall that and want to verify that information, you can simply go to the Format menu and come down to Format Section. And remember, in the upper right-hand corner here, Word tells us that after a section break, it will start a new page or any of these other options that were selected. Default is new page, and so we're aware of that. We simply can print this document, and this information will appear on our last page of the document. And now this is fully formattable text. You can format this just like any other text in your document. If you go back and change your index codes or change your document, that does not automatically update this information. You would need to delete this information and give Word the command to create another index. Well, let's exit this document without saving our changes. And let's take a look at a document that will demonstrate table of contents. Now, tables of contents are built much the same way indexes are. There are beginning and ending codes that must appear around the information. Now again, I have created text in this document that I have bolded and left aligned simply to make it stand out a bit more easily on your display screen. We could just as easily, for example, select this text in the middle of the document, XYZ, and put our beginning and ending codes around that bit of text, and Word would recognize that as an index or a table of contents item as well. Well, let's scroll down in this document and see some of the other codes that have already been placed in. You'll notice the beginning and ending codes for tables of contents are similar to what we use for indexes, but notice instead of an I, we use a C. I for index, C for table of contents. So we would type in a period and a C and a period and select that text, give it the hidden format, and a closing entity would be the semicolon, just like in indexing, and we would select and dot or hide that text. So let's go up here and do that. We'll place our insertion point, type a period, a C and a period in, select that text, go to Format, Character, and click on the last attribute down here, number 8, which is hidden. Click on OK. That puts the dotted underline under that bit of text. Now we put a semicolon in there, select it, and do the same thing. Format Character, and click on Hidden Format. Now there is a shorter method. Just as we did with indexes, we can, with Table of Contents, select the text and go to our Document menu and say Insert a Table of Contents entry, TOC standing for Table of Contents. When we do that, it'll put the period C period before that text item as well. Now I've gone through and done placed our at our Table of Contents beginning and ending codes on each of these items, and notice there's a bit of a difference here. This one says period C2 period. That 2 represents a level of nesting. In other words, the words option 1 and option 2 will be nested under compensation options as a heading. Now we've gone all the way through this document. We've added our beginning and ending codes. Now we simply go to the Utilities menu and tell Word to create a table of contents. It prompts us with a little different dialog box. This one is asking us, are we in the outline mode or the period C period paragraph mode? This is the option we're using here. We're using period C periods, and we want to show all page numbers, so we'll leave that selected. We click on Start. Word will repaginate this document and shift it down and place our table of contents at the beginning of our document with a section break separating those two portions of the document. Notice that our index, our table of contents items are left aligned, and there is a tab leader that's been added, and the page numbers now appear against the right-hand margin. And of course, this is simply good form for a table of contents, and so Word automatically creates that for you. Notice also that option 1 and option 2 are now nested under the heading Compensation Options. Again, there's a section break that separates these two portions of the document. Since the section attribute has been given to send it to a new page, this would print as our first page and this the second. You can see evidence of that by going to the Print Preview under the File menu, and you'll see the table of contents is on one page and the beginning of the document on another. Well, let's cancel from that window and close this document without saving our changes. So as you can see, it's a fairly simple matter to create indexes and tables of contents in Word 4.0. Let's take a moment now and talk about footnoting. You may want to create a document where you want to make reference to the contents of your document at the bottom of the page with footnoting references. Word makes it very easy for you to do footnotes. If you'll notice, the document I have on the screen now is our computer security document. If we wanted to create footnotes to make reference at the bottom of our document to text somewhere in there, the first thing you need to do is place your insertion point where you want the footnote to live. So let's go down here to this second paragraph here, right after the word transfer, electronic money transfer. Let's place our insertion point right there. With the insertion point placed, we can simply go to the document menu and come down to footnote. Command E is the keyboard equivalent. If I release on footnote, Word prompts me with this little dialog box. And it says, first of all, do we want to use an auto-numbered reference? That is, if we're going to use Arabic numerals, do we want them to number the footnotes sequentially? That is 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth. If so, we'll leave this box checked. If not, of course, we could deselect it. If we deselect that box, notice that automatically activates our footnote reference mark box. And Word is prompting us with the option of using an asterisk for our first footnote. Well, for this first footnote, I think I will use the auto-numbered reference. We'll use footnotes that are numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth. Notice these footnote separator buttons that are listed down here. If we were to select this little button, Word would place about a 2-inch line separating or between our footnotes and the text of our document, separating the two. If you were to depress this button, Word would place a continuous separator, that is a line all the way across the bottom of the document, separating the footnotes from the other or the rest of the document. And this one is a continuation notice. If we wanted to continue our footnotes on another page, we could then click on this button. If we don't choose any of them, Word will automatically, by default, select this first one. So let's just leave them alone and click on OK. When we click on OK, you'll notice Word splits the screen. And now at the bottom of the screen, we see the footnote reference number 1 automatically placed there. And notice the number 1 has automatically been placed in our document, but it's been placed in as a superscript. That is, it has been raised, the number 1 has been raised above the baseline, 3 points. And the size, or the point size of that number, has been reduced a few points as well. Well, now our insertion point is placed right down here, so we can then type in some text. So let's type in the text footnote number 1. Now, if you want to place another footnote, you can go back into the document and do that. So let's go to another location here. How about after the word account at the end of that sentence? If we place our insertion point there, we can then simply go to footnote or document footnote. We want all things to remain the same, so we leave these as set. Click on OK, and now it puts the number 2 down in there. You see it automatically is numbering our footnotes for us because the auto-numbered reference has been selected. So we could then put some text in here. This is footnote number 2. And let's do it one more time. How about right here at the end of our second paragraph, let's place a marker right there. So we put a footnote in at the end. Document, footnote, everything is the same, so we'll click on OK, and it puts the number 3 in, and so forth. Notice the number 3 now appears superscripted above the baseline at the end of our sentence. Footnote number 3. So now let's see the net effect of these footnotes by going to the File menu and coming down to Print Preview. And you'll notice at the bottom of the first page live our footnotes. And they are separated from the text by this separation line. If I double-click down there, it blows it up to page view, and you'll see the footnotes look very nice. Well, let's go back to our galley view by clicking on page view under the document menu. It brings us back to our galley view. Now suppose we want to change the location of our footnotes or make some adjustments, make some changes. Suppose in this case we want to delete footnote number 2. We can select footnote number 2 and simply delete it out of the document by hitting the delete key and or the backspace key. Notice it takes it out, and when you're using the auto-numbered reference option, it renumbers your footnotes in your footnote window down here at the bottom, and it also renumbers them in the document. Notice the number 2 now appears at the end of our second paragraph, even though this used to be footnote number 3. Now, the footnotes are shown in this lower portion by splitting our screen. If you take your arrow of your pointer up here and place the hot dot on top of that little black rectangle at the edge of the document, you'll notice it turns into another pointer shape, and that is two lines with arrows up and down. You may recognize that shape from Microsoft Excel. It's the same shape of the icon that splits the screen in an Excel document. Well, here we can split the screen in a Word document as well. We can raise or lower that split screen window, and we can get rid of it by dragging it off the top or the bottom. And it brings us back to a one page or to the full view of our document. Now, those footnotes live at the bottom of the first page, and we see that on the printed page. But you can send those footnotes to another area of the document as well. Now, suppose instead of at the bottom of the page where your footnotes currently live, you would rather have those footnotes at on the last page of your document, that is, at the end of your document, perhaps at the end of a given chapter or at the end of the whole book if you were writing a book. You can change the location where footnotes live by going to your Format menu and come down to the new option you see under Format, Format Document. When you open up the document dialog box, you'll notice there's a box here that deals with footnotes. And it says the position of the footnotes by default will appear at the bottom of the page. However, if you click in the down arrow, a little menu drops down and you can choose other locations. If you would rather have your footnotes be at the end of the document, of course you would release on this option. If you're using section breaks in your document and you want your footnotes at the end of each section, then you would use this option. Footnotes beneath text simply means to place your footnotes at the bottom of the text. Now, suppose, for example, you have your footnotes living at the bottom of the page like we do here. And you want those footnotes, instead of living at the bottom of the page, to be beneath the text. If you have a full page of text, they are in fact beneath the text and at the bottom of the page. But suppose you have only text that occupies the first half of your page. To select the option that says beneath text would raise your footnotes to just beneath the text, as opposed to leaving them at the bottom of the page. Well, in this case, let's change it so that our footnotes live at the end of the document. So we'll go to the last option down here, End of Document, and now click on OK. Now you'll notice when we show the print preview, our footnotes do not live now at the bottom of the first page where they did before, but rather if we go to the end of the document, you'll see the footnotes live at the end of the document. And if we were to place a section break in here, we could send them over to a page all by themselves if we wanted that to be the case. So you see, creating footnotes in Word is a fairly simple operation. Well, let's exit this document. And now let's take just a moment and talk about outlining. You may want to create a document in Microsoft Word, but it's fuzzy in your mind the exact form that you'd like to use for the document. That is, you've got a head full of information and you need to get it into your document, but you're not sure what should come before what. It might be helpful for you to create an outline of that information first. And then, when you have your outline created, go back in and fill in the particulars and thus help you organize your document. Well, outlining is a very powerful option in Microsoft Word. You'll notice on the screen now, I've got a document that that shows an outline, or that is, it shows the first caption of the main heading of what I want to write about here, in this case, a basic word processing. And then notice all of these little options down below. Those are subheadings in my outline. And notice also underneath each of these subheadings, you see a little dotted line. That little dotted line indicates there is more text to follow. There are items nested underneath each of these headings. Notice also in the outline, we have a special bar here at the top that takes the place of the normal ruler when you're in the normal galley view of a document. Now, before I explain this special ruler at the top of the outline portion of our document, let's go back and take a look at the galley view of the document. That is the normal composition mode of our document. You can switch from the outlining to the galley view back and forth by going to the document menu. And while selecting the document menu, come down to the word outlining. Notice the little check mark is by outlining. This simply toggles on and off. If I click on outlining again, it takes me back to the composition view of the document, and this is the normal or galley view. Notice now each of these headings, each of those items that are listed in bold print are those that are headings in our outline. That is to say, each one of these has been given a heading status. All the text that appears underneath it is in plain text, that is not formatted as bold, is simply plain text that we have added after we created those outline headings. All right, well, let's go back to the document menu and go back to outlining and take a look at the document now while it's in its outline mode. These four numbers that you see right over here are the levels of the outline. If I simply click on level number one, it shows me all items that were level one items in our outline. In this case, I only had one, and that was basic word processing. That's the heading, the first heading in our document. And then underneath basic word processing, I had all of my other leveled headings. So if I click on number two, it shows me all second level headings. Click on number three, all third level, fourth level, all the way out to this little square icon right here, which takes us all the way out to all levels of the document. Plus, it shows us the first line of text. Now, notice these little icons out here in the left-hand end of each paragraph. This little plus, this outlined plus symbol, indicates that underneath this paragraph there are more subheadings. Likewise, this plus symbol indicates the same. The minus symbol, this outlined minus sign, indicates there are no longer any subheadings under this caption. The little square here indicates that this is a text portion and not a heading portion of this outline. Now notice that my arrow, when I land on top of one of those little items, turns into a little icon that has four arrows on it, one pointing in each direction of the compass. When the icon is in that position, I can grab that icon or select the text. Each time I grab one of those icons, it will select the text associated with those, and then I can move it around. You notice as I move to the left, my pointer now turns into a set of arrows right and left, and I get the dotted line that's showing me the next level of nesting that it'll move over to when I release the mouse button. So if I release the mouse button, now that promotes that item. If I drag backwards, it will demote it back to its regular position. Now this promotion and demotion within the outline can be accomplished by these arrows up here as well. You'll notice if I place my insertion point right here, for example, and I want to promote this item in the outline, I can click on the left arrow and it promotes it up the same direction. Right arrow promotes it back, or demotes it back. Now, these two arrows here will promote it up or down within the outline. So if I have my insertion point placed there and click on the up arrow, you see it changes places with the item above it. It promotes it. This one would then demote it in the same direction. And in our normal view of the document, any text associated with each level of the outline will also move with these headings. This particular icon here with the arrow and the shield over the front of it will simply demote whatever it is we have selected to text, as opposed to leaving it as an outline heading. So if I select that one, I can click on the demotion icon, and now it demotes that whole bit of text to just text within the document, as opposed to an outline heading. Well, I don't want to do that in this case, so I'll go back to the edit menu and notice now our undo option is available. It says undo make body text. I will undo that, and it brings me back now to a level of an outline heading. These two icons over here, if I click on this one, it will simply show or not show all of our body text by clicking on it. And this one over here will either show formatting or not formatting, or no formatting. You see now all the bold has been taken out. If I click on it, it will bring the bold back to show headings and the plain text to show plain text. Well, an effective way of learning how to do outlining is seeing it done. So let's create a new document. And while we're in the galley view, we go to the document menu. Come down to outlining. That gives us our outlining ruler here, and notice now it shows us that we have no headings at this point. That bolded minus sign indicates we simply have no headings below anything in the document. Well, let's type a heading in there. Let's type what we had before. And notice now as I type, I can click on level one, That is now a level one heading. If I hit my return key, it drops down. I'm at the same level. But now when I tab in one, or rather, when I hit my demotion icon, I should say, and tab in, or it drops it down to nest, notice now the minus icon is turned into a plus, indicating now below this level, we now have some other levels of nesting. So we could put some other terminology in here. Editing documents, when I hit the return key, it stays at that same level of nesting, and now, or that same outline heading level. And now notice, as soon as I start typing, you'll see this icon change. When I hit the return key, type another level heading in there. And so forth. Now, if I want these to be nested under editing documents, I can simply place the insertion point and demote them, and you see this icon changes. If I want this one to be nested under printing, I can demote it twice. The second time forces the icon to change. So these icons will change as soon as you get nested text underneath them. And now this has been reduced to plain text in the document. If I go back to the document menu and come down to outlining, it takes me back to the galley view. And now while I'm in galley view, I can go up here and put text in, for example, under this heading that says editing documents. And so forth. You see, this is standard text. If I show the outline view again, you'll see that ends up being just plain text. It is not a part of the heading. Now watch what happens when I promote or demote printing documents. If I want to promote that above the heading below it, now when I go back to my outlining or document menu to outlining to come back to the galley view, you'll see those text items have changed in that view as well. All right, now let's take a moment and talk about the mail merge capabilities of Word. You can create lists of names of individuals. Suppose, for example, you wanted to keep a track of a list of all the people to whom you will send Christmas cards this year. You can list all of those names and addresses create a document in Word where you keep track of all those names, and then create your own Christmas card, for example, and merge the names with that card so that you print a new document for each individual. You could use the same ability to create lists of names of business clients and send letters to them and so forth. Now that's called the mail merge. You can do mail merging in Word fairly easily. I'll go to the screen now and open up a document that I've prepared for this in a folder that I've called Merge Examples. And I'll open up the first one I've called a form letter. This is a letter that we're going to merge our names with. And I'll also open up another one that I have called Form List. Now first let me explain this document to you. First I'll show the ruler. This is simply a list of names of individuals to whom we are going to send our letter. Notice I have each of them listed underneath a category heading, that is name, company, address, city, and so forth. And each of these categories now are set off on our ruler by tabs. These are left-aligned tabs to keep track of each one of these headings. Notice under the word city, I've got some text, and the text is enclosed within quotation marks. Well, the reason I have quotation marks around this text is because of this little comma right there. You see, Word allows you to create your data files and to separate your names with what are called delimiters. You can set up a tab delimited file or a comma delimited file. In other words, instead of putting all of our column headings here on tabs, I could have put the word name, comma, company, comma, address, comma, and so forth, and used commas to separate each of these captions. Commas would then be my delimiter. But whenever you choose to use a comma in text in the document, as well as have your categories offset by tab delimiters, Word gets confused and thinks you're trying to use commas and tabs at the same time. So the caution is, and the way I designed this example is to show this particular caution, that is, if you're going to use commas in your text, you must surround that string of text in quotation marks so that Word recognizes that this comma is simply a text comma and not a delimiter to separate your categories. All right, so notice now I have name, company, address, city, and greeting. I did not put city, state, and zip, but rather put them all in one line, consequently the need for that comma. On the next example, we'll show you without the comma and individual headings, which makes it a bit easier. And my last item in my data file is called greeting. Now this document I simply arbitrarily called form list. I could have given this document any name, but since the letter I'm using it with I called form letter, it helps me keep track of the two so I know they go together. Notice also that my margin indicator is out here at the 9-inch mark. I have gone way past my warning line here at 6 inches. Well, that's all right in this particular case because this document I'm calling a data file. That is, it is a document that is simply going to keep track of the names for me. And I'm not going to print this document, so I don't have to worry about my page setup options, my margin settings for the printed document. I'm simply going to use this as a reference file, in other words. All right, I have the other document also open at this time, so let's go to the window menu and bring up form letter. This is the letter now that we're going to use to merge these names with. Notice the first entry in my letter is a set of left chevrons, the word data, and the name of the file of my list of names, that is, form list, and a set of right chevrons. This is the entry that must appear at the beginning of all of your documents if you're going to do a merge. Now, if you don't remember where to get your chevrons, simply investigate your keycaps. If you go to the Apple menu and come down to keycaps, you'll notice the backslash key just to the right of your space bar. If you'll hold your option key down, notice underneath the backslash there's a set of left chevrons. So to get the left chevrons you want in the upper left-hand corner of the document, you hold the option key down and type your backslash key. If you hold the option and the shift key down, you'll notice your left chevrons turn into a set of right chevrons. So if you forget where they are, simply investigate your keycaps. Now I'll go down here and I will type this same line down here just to show you how I created that. Held the option key down and hit the backslash key. That gives the chevrons. And I typed in the word data. It does not have to be uppercase. It is not case sensitive. And then I typed the name of my file, which was form list. Then I held the option and the shift keys down together and typed a backslash, which gives me then the right chevrons. So this is the first entry that must appear in your document. Now notice each of these items down here that have chevrons around them, they are the column headings that came out of our data file document called form list. So on letter number one, the first name and their company and their respective address and so forth will be merged into this letter. And the last item down here is a greeting. All of the other text in this letter that is not encased in chevrons simply is normal text of the document. So the date and the word dear and the rest of the document are simply normal text. All right, now to see the effect of this, we want to merge the names with our file. So we simply, with both of them open, go to the File menu and come down to Print Merge. When we release on Print Merge, you'll notice this little button right here, if we click on print, it will start merging those names one at a time with our merged document and print them individually. If we click on this button, however, that says new document, Word will create a brand new document and merge the names together with the letter in that document so we can see the effect of that merge before we send it to print. So let's click on new document. Word calls this new document form letters number one. And now that you'll see the merge has taken place. This says June 25th. This goes to Lois Lane at the Daily Universe. Dear Miss Lane, notice all of the entries have come in and are formatted just as though we had originally typed that letter as an individual letter. It separates each one of these with a section break And now here is the second letter. This letter goes to Captain Kirk from Enterprise, Inc. The third letter is also set off by a section break. And you see it goes to Mr. Spock from Spock's Beaming Company. The end of the document marker appears at the end of this document. Now this is a brand new document that Word created. We could print this document if we wanted. However, that's not really what it was designed for. You see, we have a rather small data file here. We have a data file with only three names in it. So when we told Word to create a new document, it merged all three names, created a new document, offset them with section breaks, which in this case will send those documents to the new page. Therefore, we could print this. But suppose you had a data file, let's say with 792 names in it. You wouldn't necessarily want to create a merged document with all 792 names merged. Obviously, you couldn't do that because Word would not create a document that was 792 pages long. So instead, we would select a few of those names and do a merge new document to see the effect of that merge. And if we see that it's all right, we would typically delete this document without saving its changes. And we would go back then to our merge document and do a print merge. Well, let's take a look at another example. I'll close these without saving the changes. Let's take a look at a couple of documents. One I've entitled Magazine Merge, which is the name of the letter. And we'll open up another one. And it is called Magazine. It is the data file that supports Magazine Merge. Again, I've got two documents open now. This first one is just a list of all the names we're going to merge. So let's show the ruler. You'll see each of these now are set up on tabs. You could, again, use commas if you wanted. Notice over here now, after city and state and zip, I have no greeting here. We'll show you how I deal with the greetings here in just a moment. Notice I don't have to worry about commas here. I simply set each of these categories up on their own tab, and so I don't have to deal with commas and quotation marks. Well, I have no greeting. We'll show you that in a minute. Notice the next three entries. The next three entries are MAG, which stands for magazine. We're, in this case, acting like a publisher. People are writing to us wanting to subscribe to our magazines. And so the first magazine that people are writing for, I've listed under the name MAG. Term is the term of the subscription they're writing to us for. MAG 2 is the second magazine, and Term 2 is the second term of the magazine. So in other words, if folks are writing in to subscribe to two magazines, this would be the second term of their magazine subscription. And the last entry here says sub-year. That's the subscription year. That's when they first started subscribing to our magazines. Notice one is as early as 1979 and the latest 1988. Now this is a data file. I'm not going to print this document, so I have not been careful about my margin settings here. You see I have moved well past the warning line. Now I could wrap these around and stay within that warning line and Word would deal with them just as well. I simply like to see them spread out all on one line. It makes it easier to keep track of. Now the name of this document is Magazine. It is the data file of our names. Let's open up, or let's bring to the front our window that is the document with which we will merge these names. Now you'll notice the first option up here is our left chevrons, the word data, and the name Magazine. Notice no right chevrons here because I have a couple of other options taking place and my ending right chevrons are out here at the end. This first set option here will do a substitution. I'm going to allow my customers to get a free trial subscription of this magazine, Computers Today, if they qualify. And we'll see later on in the document how we set up the qualification criteria. This second set will build a little dialog box for me on the screen, and it will allow me then to type the date into the dialog box. The dialog box will simply ask me the question, what is today's date, and give me a place where I can type that date in. And I ended the set command with our set of right chevrons. Now notice the first entry here, name, that's the first entry out of our data file, then address. City, state, and zip are all enclosed in their own chevrons. The comma that is right here is just simple or plain text of my normal text in the document. I placed a couple of spaces in here to separate the state from the zip, so we have a little space in the printed document. Now notice the greeting here. Since I did not have a greeting caption in my data file to merge into this letter, I'm using a logic or an if statement to suffice for the greeting. It says this: if the person's entry under subyear is less than 82, that means the person whose name is being merged into this document has been subscribing to our magazines for a longer period than 5 years, then we will address this letter to them as dear longtime friend. If this is not the case, if the subyear entry is greater than 82, Word will simply skip over the longtime friend, and in other words, or else, it will simply say dear friend. Now that's basically the way logic statements work. Logic statements work like this. They say if one condition exists, then do something. If this condition does not exist, skip over that first option and do something else instead. And so that's what's happening here. And notice there is an end to the if statement and a set of right chevrons. So we're going to customize how we greet the people with this letter. All right, now the first paragraph says, thank you very much for your recent order for term. That's so many months of a certain magazine. Notice the first letter here in the word term has been bolded. When you bold that first letter, the whole entry will come in as bold. When you bold and italicize the first letter under mag, the whole entry will come in with those formats. So it says, thanks for your recent order of so many months of a magazine. Now I have a second logic statement here. It says, if there is a term two, in other words, if they're in fact ordering a second magazine, then say, and so many months of a second magazine. End to the if statement. Notice in this case, this logic statement we did not give an alternative course of action for. We simply said, if there is a term two, do this. The end to that if statement placed right here indicates that if this is not true, Word will simply disregard this whole piece of text, and it will wrap our text back and just act as though there was no second subscription. Now down a little further in the document, notice we've got a paragraph down here that says we've received approval from our publisher to include some free prizes here. And it says we're also going to give a 12-month trial subscription to Sub. Remember where you saw sub? Sub was at the top of our document. It's going to be a substitution take place, and Computers Today is going to be merged from our merge document into itself. So you see, this is one way you can merge within the document itself. Now notice down here I've got three more logic statements. This first one says, if the first term subscription is greater than 18. In other words, the first magazine they're subscribing for is greater than 18 months. And if the second term of their subscription to this magazine is greater than 18 months, then we're going to include a special prize. Well, this include function allows you to go to another document and take information from that other document and include it in this one. Well, the name of the other document is Prize. I haven't opened it yet. If I go to the File menu and come down to Open, you'll see on my disk, Prize is a document that appears on my hard disk. I don't need to open it. Word will go get the information from that document and include it in this document by using this include function. Now, since I had two if statements out here, two criteria, it requires me to put two ends to the if statement here. Now here's the third logic statement. It says, if subyear is less than 82, in other words, these folks have been subscribing for a long time to our magazine, then whether or not they comply with these limitations up here, we're going to include the prize anyway. End to the if statement. All right, that's all I've done on this document. So let's scroll back to the beginning, and let's tell Word now to merge our merge letter with our data file. We'll go to the File menu, come down to Print Merge. We'll ask Word to build a new document for us so we can see the effect of the merge. Now notice this command up here said was going to ask us through a dialog box what the date is. There's that dialog box. So we'll type today's date in. Click on the OK button, and that merges the date into the document, and there's our first letter. See, it shows the date at the top, July 17th. This goes to Mr. Philip Morris in Pittsburgh, PA. It says, "Dear friend, he is a short-term subscriber, isn't he?" The logic statement in the merged letter indicates here now that he has subscribed after 1982, therefore it says, "Dear friend." And now it says, "Thank you for your recent order for 24 months of Pop Rock, a certain magazine." Notice 24 comes in bold, and Pop Rock is bolded as well as italicized. And this particular individual is ordering a second magazine, so he's ordering 12 months of Modern Persons. The both of them have been entered. Notice a little further down, Computers Today has been added. This is the substitution that's coming to us off the top of our original merge file. Notice here also, he did not subscribe for more than 18 months of both magazines. Because he did not, he therefore does not qualify for the prize, and so you'll see the prize is not included down here. It simply has been left blank. When we scroll forward to the next letter, you'll see it's separated by a section break. Now this is to Mr. George Burns in Seattle. It says, "Dear friend, he is also a short-term subscriber. Thanks for 36 months of Natural Man, 24 months of Boys Laugh." Well, he's subscribing for more than 18 months of two magazines, therefore he qualifies for our prize, doesn't he? Down here we're giving him a trial subscription to Computers Today, and if I scroll up, you'll see here is the prize. The prize has been entered now from another document that's not open. It says, "Since he has subscribed for more than 18 months of our prestigious magazines, he's been chosen to receive our Popular Publishers Clearinghouse edition of Party Jokes for the Infirm of Mind at no additional charge." So he gets the free prize because he's subscribed to more than 18 months of two magazines. Well, here's our third one. This goes to Maul Flanders. Notice here, this says, "Dear longtime friend, she's been subscribing for a while to our magazines. She's ordering 18 months of Ingenious and 12 months of Fortunate. She has not ordered more than 18 months of each, but you recall the earlier logic statement said if she'd been subscribing for a long time, she also gets the prize." And lastly, we have one that goes to Ichabod Crane in Sleepy Hollow, Colorado. This says, "Dear friend, he's been a short-term subscriber. He's only ordering 6 months of one magazine. He's not ordering any second magazine, therefore he only gets the one issue or the one magazine and no prize." So you see, you can use the mail merge in Word to do some very interesting things for you. You can customize the letters, your letters, and the way these merged entries will come into them. Well, let me show you one other option here, one further document that I've created to create memos for those who may be in the business of writing memos at work. This is a memo form that simply uses these different set functions to create dialog boxes that pop up on the screen to ask questions of the end user. So if you write memos on a regular basis, you might want to create something like this where you lay out your format as you want it to be. Here I put a dark line underneath our heading here so it separates this portion from the bottom portion of the document. And each one of these set boxes now will give us a dialog box that asks this question: what is the date, to whom is the memo written, from whom, and what the subject title is. Now we're not going to merge this document with a data file, but rather we're going to merge this document with simply the entries that we put into these boxes when they appear on the screen. So let's go to the File menu, come down to Print Merge, we'll tell Word to give us a new document. And now notice here's that first box. It says, "What is the date?" Well, we'll put today's date in. Hit the Enter key or click on the OK box and it gives us the next box. It says, "To whom is this memo written?" Well, let's type in, this goes to Big John. Enter. It says, "From whom?" This is coming from Little Louie. Okay. And it says put the subject title here. Well, we could put a title in something like this. End quote. Click on OK, and you'll see this merges now with our memo. It is all lined up nicely. We can simply place our insertion point down here and type out the memo. And since this is a one-of-a-kind memo, we could then print this document, for it is a brand new Word document that Word has created. We could print this document and be on our way. Instead of the word memo, you could put a nice graphic up here or your letterhead or some such thing as that. And so you see how these set functions then allow you some flexibility in doing routine tasks. End users can put the information in to be merged into your documents. Word has added a new function to its repertoire. It's called the tables option. You can create tables of information in Word now. And the tables option replaces what used to be called the side-by-side paragraph formatting option. Formerly in Word, you could create a document where you had paragraphs living one below another. And then in order to get them on the printed page to move up and live next to one another, you had to assign the side-by-side paragraph option to that text. Well, Word now has the ability to create text side-by-side on the screen in a table or tabular format. It looks a lot like a spreadsheet. In fact, if you were to copy information from a spreadsheet, for example, Microsoft Excel, you were to select information on a spreadsheet, copy it to the clipboard, you could paste it into your Word document, and it would enter this grid structure known as a table. It looks a lot like a spreadsheet. Well, let's take a look at how to build a table. Here we have a plain document on the screen. Let's first, before we build the document, let's go to our Edit menu and come down to Preferences. And under Preferences, we're going to want to select this box right here next to the description, Show Table Grid Lines. We're going to want to see the grid lines or the outlines around these individual cells in our document. So we'll tell Word to show our grid line preferences. And now let's go over to the Document menu and come down to Insert Table. We're prompted with a little dialog box where Word is asking us how many columns are we going to have in this table. Well, instead of two, let's say we're going to put three columns in there. How many rows? Well, in this case, let's delete one and let's put four rows in this document. Now it says by default each column will be 2 inches wide. If we have three columns times 2 inches each, that's 6 inches of text space. That ought to fit on our document. So we'll click on OK. And you'll notice then on the screen, Word builds the table. Now the insertion point is placed in one of these cells. Each cell, or each little rectangle, is its own paragraph. So now we have multiple paragraphs we can see on the same screen side by side. Well, let's place our insertion point in this first cell, and let's type some text in. Let's type a list of names across here. So in our first one, perhaps we'll have the name Judy. If I hit the Tab key, the insertion point automatically jumps across to the next cell in line. So we'll put some other names in these cells. Hit the Tab key. Tab drops down one cell. Let's put the name Manny in there, and a Greg in there, and Dora, whoops, D-O-R-A, and the Louis, Chris, Harlan, now you'll notice I'm at the last cell of this table. If I hit my Tab key again, rather than wrapping back up and starting over again like a spreadsheet normally would, hitting the Tab key in this case will create another line, another row in other words, and with the same formatting attributes as those above. So we could continue this list on. And so forth. Well, let's go up here to the format menu and show our ruler. Notice that while our insertion point is in this column, one of the cells or paragraphs in this column, our ruler is defined with its zero point at the left edge of the column, and the right margin indicator then shows over here at the 2-inch mark, or just below the 2-inch mark. If I click in one of these other cells, you'll see the ruler definition changes, and now I'm working in the center portion of the ruler. And likewise over here, it moves backward. Now suppose we'd like to sort the information in any given column. Suppose this center column, for example. Notice as I raise my insertion, my pointer, to the top cell, as soon as it gets to the top cell of that table, it turns into a dark arrow pointing down. When it is in that shape, you can simply click once on the mouse button, and that will select that column. Now we can sort this information, that is, we can place these names in alphabetical order if we wish, and all of the related data on each side will sort with them. While it's selected, let's go to the Utilities menu and come down to the last option, which is Sort. When I release on Sort, it automatically sorts that information. So the second column now is sorted, and the related information on each side also moves, so we maintain the relationship between Tom, Bill, and Karen. Well, if you would like to sort it in the opposite direction, that is, this was an ascending sort, that is, from A to Z. If you want to reverse that direction, you can simply hold the Shift key down. And now notice when we go to the Utilities menu, it says Sort Descending. The word descending is added when we hold the Shift key. That reverses its direction. So if we release on it, it will sort in reverse order, T down through B. Now while this column is selected, suppose we want to reduce the size of these five paragraphs. We can do so by downsizing this column, moving this the right column margin to the left. And the way you are able to accomplish that is to go first up here to your scale icon. This little icon right here sends you to the different forms of the ruler. If I click once, it shows me now my table view of the ruler, or my table ruler. And notice now where each of these columns are set, there is a T up in the ruler indicating that's the break or the end of that column. So if I simply go with my mouse arrow up there and grab that column indicator and drag it to the left, notice it moves to the left, and in the lower left-hand corner in my status box, you'll see the size of that column being diminished as I move it to the left. However, notice all the way to the right as well, that column marker is moving with it. So when you simply grab one, the both of them move. Well, the way you can separate this one to move by itself is simply hold the Shift key down. While the Shift key is in its down position, then simply grab that one and it will allow you to downsize a middle column or any column without changing the size of any of the other columns at the same time. Release the key and the mouse button, and now you'll see my inside paragraphs are much smaller. While inside a given paragraph, if you hit your return key, it will simply expand the size of that cell, and the cells in the same row will also expand. Hit the delete key, it takes that paragraph symbol out. Suppose we want these three paragraphs to be merged into one. That is, we want Judy and Tom and Jim all to be merged together. Well, if you go out here to your selection bar and double click, it will select that whole row. While the row is selected, we can go to the Edit menu and come down to Table. We're going to edit the table in this case. You'll notice there is a button in here that says Merge Cells. If I select Merge Cells, it will merge the contents of those three paragraphs and make it one paragraph. Of course, the reverse of that will also apply, so that is if we go to the Edit menu and come down to Table, what used to say Merge Cells now says Split Cell. If you click on Split Cell, it brings them back to the contents of three separate paragraphs. But notice now, it came back to the original settings on our table ruler. So if we bring this, if we hold the Shift key down and bring this right one over, we could line it up again with the others. Now you can put graphics into individual cells, you can put text, you can put numbers, You recall at the beginning of this video we talked about how to add columns of numbers. If you put a column of numbers in a table, you can select that whole column and use the calculate function in Word to calculate the results as well. You can also border these cells if you want. Let's for the sake of example here, let's go up to the Edit menu and come down to Preferences, and we'll turn off the option to see our grid lines. Now you'll see we're dealing with just paragraphs, individual paragraphs by themselves. Let's show our paragraph symbols. Whenever you show the paragraph symbols, the grid lines come back. And also we see these little dots at the end. These are called end of cell markers. A little black dot simply indicates where the end of that individual paragraph within that cell lives. To turn off the paragraph symbols, hide paragraph symbols, takes the grid lines out as well as those end of cell indicators. So you see, now it appears as though we simply have a document that's set up on tabs, perhaps. Or at least it looks like one that could have been set up on tabs, but of course we know it is now involved in a table. You also have the ability in Word to link a spreadsheet to Word. If you are running the Multifinder and you have Word and Excel, for example, loaded at the same time, you can create what's called a soft link between the two. That is, you could create a spreadsheet in Excel and then send that information over to Word, and it would fill it into a table much like you have seen created here. All right, well, let's close this document without saving the changes. And let's take a moment now and talk about style sheets. I like to think of Word as creating a document that has two faces to it. That is, one face or page of the document we see on the display screen. In the galley view, we see the composition of our document. But there's another sheet out here somewhere that Word keeps track of all the formatting attributes that we have given our document, and that sheet is called a style sheet. Now, we typically don't see a style sheet on the screen, but Word is keeping track of all those formats for us as we format our documents. Now, remember earlier in the tape when we talked about the glossary, we selected items that we wanted to place in the glossary, and then we opened our glossary window and gave each of those items a name, and then clicked on the Define button to enter those items into our directory. And then Word kept track in a special storage place of all those items we had in the glossary, so we could pull them up and paste them into the document at will. When we placed the item in the glossary, Word kept track of the text of the item as well as all of its formatting. When you use style sheets, you're simply concerned with the formatting only and not the text. But they work a lot alike, the glossary and the style sheets. So let's open up a new document to begin with. And let's show our ruler. We'll center align our text, and let's format the text that's going to live here using a different font than our default font. So let's go to, let's choose a Chicago font. And let's choose, we'll leave it at 12-point Chicago for the title. Let's put a heading up here for our letterhead. I hit the return key, drops down one line and creates another paragraph in the process. Let's put the address in. Drop down another paragraph. Now we've created a letterhead. If we want to save this letterhead, that is Chicago font, 12-point, center aligned text, and bolded, if we want to save those styles, we can select that text and go to our Format menu and come down to Define Styles. Now, it tells us under Define Styles that there is only one set of styles so far that have been defined, and that is normal. What is our normal style? That is, it is New York 12-point flush left. That's what Word comes with as a default setting. Well, in this particular version of Word, I have modified it, so now I'm using Geneva 12-point flush left as my default fonts. But this new style that I have just created back here is now the normal font, which are our default settings. However, there's been a font substitution now. When I typed this letterhead in, Word automatically came down here and started listing the changes that I was making. That is, I substituted Chicago font and I center aligned the text. So while this information is here, if I wanted to make that text bold, for example, since this is an active window, I could go to the Format menu and come down to Bold, and it would make the text bold. Now I have three options, formatting options set: a new font, bold, and centered. If I would like to define this now as my style of choice, I can simply give this style a name. If I wanted to call this letterhead, much like we did in our glossary example, and I click on the button Define, that style is now defined as a style in Word and its name placed in alphabetical order in this little directory. So now at some other point in time in my document, if I chose to use this style, I could call that style up without the text, just the formatting, and type again. Simply click on OK, and it puts that window away, and now those attributes have been assigned. It is now bolded, center aligned, Chicago font. Now suppose we come down here and I want to create a new style. If I hit my return a couple times, I will left align our text. And now let's format this differently. Let's make this one, let's say Geneva font. It's already 12 point, and let's make this plain text. So we're back to what is my normal font. Or instead of giving those attributes individually, I simply could have gone back up here to my style status box and simply clicked on normal as a defined style, and that's now what would be assigned to the current style that I'm typing. So I could then, for example, put a name in here and an address and a city and so forth. And notice I'm typing now in a different style. This style is called normal. You also see it down here in our style status box. So you can create individual styles and remember the names of those styles and then apply those formats to other documents. Well, let me close this document and let's open up another one that I've already created that is filled already with a whole series of styles. And I've called that a style example. Notice my letterhead here is Stuttgart font, 12 point, bold, and center aligned. What I did was I selected this text once I created it, and I went to the Format menu, came down to Define Styles, and I called it a letterhead. So I typed the name letterhead in my style box, so it looked just like this. I clicked on the Define button, and it put its name up here in alphabetical order, along with all the other styles. And it tells me that style is the normal font, that is our default setting, plus there was a font substitution. Stuttgart font, bolded, center aligned, and it says spaces before this text, 0 points. That means this text bumps right up against the top of our document. In other words, the top margin of our document. And I did that as I went along. I selected another style here. I came down and typed in my date. And what I did was then I selected the space above and below it. And when I did so, I then went back to Format, Define Styles again, and gave this style a name, and I called this the date. I typed date in this box, clicked on Define, and its style name entered into our directory. And I simply did that all the way down this document. Each time I created a new style, I gave it a name. So you'll see down here this particular style, when I place my insertion point in this paragraph, it says the style I'm currently using is one called Body. It has its own attributes, Format, Define Styles. When I click on Body, it shows me those styles listed here. So these styles could then be used over and over again in this document or simply placed into another document. If I wanted to place these styles in another document, I could simply open a new document. What styles are attached to this one? Format, Define Styles, just the normal style. Well, while this window is open, I can simply go to my file menu and open up another document that has other styles in it. Notice, since our Define Styles window is open, when we go to the File Open menu, it now says Select a Style Sheet. When you're in a normal document, typically it says Select a Document. But now what we have the ability to do is take any of the styles that have been attached to any of these Word documents and load those styles into this new document. Let's choose our style example. Click on Open. The document doesn't open, but rather all of its styles are loaded into this window. Now I can choose any one of these styles, and notice as I do, I'm already set up and ready to use that style. You see the text then comes in formatted in Stuttgart font, center aligned, and bolded. So styles will allow you to then create form documents. For example, if you work in an office where you create, where you type certain letters and they always are in the same form or format, why not create a style sheet for those letters? Create all of the styles, then simply move through your document assigning those individual styles to the document as you go, and it saves a lot of time. Well, I'm going to close this document without saving the changes, and we will quit Word. Notice when I quit Word, the last thing it asks me is, do you wish to save the changes you've made to your glossary? Recall back at the beginning of the tape when we were making changes to our glossary? The glossary is attached to Word, the application. And therefore, when we're going to close Word, the last thing it asks us is, do we wish to save the changes that we've made to those glossaries? In this case, I'll say no. It then does not save the changes to the glossary and brings us back to the desktop. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this tour of Microsoft Word 4.0. Microsoft has done a very good job in updating the previous versions of this word processing program. As you can see, you've got lots of opportunity now to do some very powerful things with a very good word processor. Take the time and work with Word. Spend some time on each one of these categories that we've discussed. As you spend a little bit of time with them, you'll see they're really quite simple, and you'll move on to then being a power user in Word. Thank you very much. Good luck in your word processing.